Good morning, everyone. How are you guys doing today? Some of you are doing good. The other ones, we're going to make you good by the end of the service today. We are so excited that you're here. Welcome to Epic Life Church. We're going to kick things off this morning, so why don't you stand up as we start singing some songs today. We just invite you guys to relax and enjoy yourself today.
I'm waking up and I come alive.
God is good, and he can take a day that maybe for us feels not so good and turn it into a good one. If you fix your eyes on him today, you can't go wrong.
So good. With every breath that I am able, well, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so
Would you pray with me? God, this morning, that song is just a reminder to us of your goodness, a reminder for us to fix our eyes on you, to remember that whatever we're going through, whatever we're in right now, you are there with us. God, it is in the difficult times that you carry us. This morning, we lift our eyes up to you and our hearts turn towards you in worship. Receive our worship today. We thank you, God. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, before you take a seat, turn to several folks near you that you didn't come with. Say good morning, welcome to Epic, and then you may take your seat.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Epic Life Church. We are so glad that you're joining us today. I'm Sandy. I'm on staff here, and we just want to say welcome. It's so good when we have the opportunity to get together and get encouraged and to grow in following Jesus. I want to let you know, if this is your first time with us, we are so glad that you're joining us today and exploring what Epic is all about. We have a free gift for you. It's just our way of saying thank you for popping in today. It's a book called How Good Is Good Enough, and you can pick it up at the very front entrance doors on your way out. And once again, we just hope you're just sit back, relax, enjoy the rest of the service. Now, hopefully everybody received a program when they came in this morning into the auditorium. Inside there, some information, including this bright orange connection card that we use around here. This is how we communicate with one another. So fill out as much as you feel comfortable with. If you're new with us today, on the back, we have opportunity to take next steps. So Pastor Mike will be talking about that later on in the message, as well as there's opportunities for prayer requests and to sign up for some stuff. First thing we have coming up that you can sign up for is if you have previously been in an Epic Life group, we invite you to possibly host one, at least find out some information about doing that. We already have some cool new group people stepping up with some cool new options coming up this fall. So if we've been growing this summer and we want to provide an opportunity for everybody to have the chance to connect, and you know, groups should not be like 50 people. So we want to provide enough options where everybody can plug in. There'll be different days of the week, different topics, different demographics. So if you're interested in finding out more about that, you can indicate that on your connection card. Tracy, our group's director, will contact you. And then also want to let you guys know, I am the student director around here, next gen director, actually 0 through 12th. You think you're tired if you have a kid. I'm telling you. No, I'm just joking. I love our next generation, and we are super excited to host a Next Generation Sunday, which is coming up on the 22nd. Our students will be leading, our middle school through high school students will be leading from the street to the seats. So if you have a student and would like to plug them in, I would love to talk to you about that. We have several different positions that we can hook them up with, from being, if they're a little more shy, to being up here in the band. We're looking for some more band members. So be here to participate in that and cheer on our next generation. Should we be cheering on our next generation? Like, guys, they're our future, right? Like, we need to hook them up, build up new leaders, right? Awesome leaders who love Jesus, who can go out and change the world. So participate in that. Now, also, because we're moving into fall, who has got more cobwebs in their house now? I'm not alone in this, right? If you're not raising your hand, you lie. They're around there. Maybe you just avoid them. No, they're not really there. So the church is the same type of environment that's really, really big, not just cobwebs, but, you know, we do a spring cleaning before Easter, and we're coming into our fall lunch. Just heads up, Pumpkin Extravaganza is coming up on October 6th. You'll find out more later. But I'm just telling you, mark your calendar for October 6th. It's going to be so much fun. But we're trying to prep for our fall, going into the fall launch, and spruce up the place. So please, if you don't mind cleaning for a couple hours, come on down. Tracy's going to be here to steer the ship, and it's going to be a party, okay? So you can sign up for that on your connection card. Once again, we'll send you more information. Now it is time to continue our Rich on Paper, Poor on Life series. So pull out your message notes. Take notes, guys. That's what it's there for, to help you in your life take steps forward. Because are you ready? Because here we go.
From the lion's head, he proved his worth. It's impossible. Nobody can jump this.
Indy! And you must hurry! Come quickly!
It's a leap of faith.
Believe, boy. You must believe.
Here I am. You know, you may or not have seen that movie before. That's Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, circa 1989, for those of you guys who want to know how old you are. And a really great clip. If you want to go watch the movie, you can. But Indiana Jones, his dad's life is on the line. He's got to take a leap of faith. Now, I've never had that big chasm, like that kind of a leap of faith before. But when I was in high school, I was at a summer camp in Idaho that had this thing called the Leap of Faith. And what it was is you went out into the woods, and there was this big, like, tree. It was more like a telephone pole. They chopped all the limbs off it. It went up about 30 feet. To give you perspective, the ceiling of this building is about 20, so about 10 feet taller than that. It's a single pole that starts about this wide down to the bottom, but it gets narrower. It's about this big at the top, and it's got all these, like, for linemen, like these little picks that they climb on, the nails or whatever, and you climb up there. Now, luckily, you're harnessed in, but you climb up there, and when you're, you know, I'm not scared of heights, so as I'm climbing up this thing, I'm like, this is easy. You get up about 20 feet, and you're like, all of a sudden, you realize that what you didn't see for other people were climbing up there is that the pole with your weight is going like this. And by the time you get to the top of that 30 feet with this thing, there's a little picture of it right there. This is the best one I could find. But you get to the very top of the thing, and then like that guy there, what do you grab onto to hold onto to stabilize yourself, to step up that last step so you can step up on there? And you have to get yourself to the very top of this pole. And when you're up on the top of it, it's wobbling around like this, like you're just doing everything you can to try and keep your balance. That's the easy part. The hard part is you're looking down 30 feet off the ground. And by the way, 30 feet looks a lot further from up there than it does down here. And for somebody who doesn't, I don't really have a problem with heights. I was a little bit like butterflies in my stomach up there at the top of this pole. But you get to the top of this pole, and there's these trees about 8 feet out, one here and one there. And between them is suspended by a cable, this big metal ring that's about 2 feet in diameter. And you're supposed to take a leap of faith off of that platform, 30 feet in the air, and reach out, lunge for it, and try to grab a hold of that ring. So I got on the edge, and I'm like, ready, I'm ready. I'm like, one, two, three, and I jump what I didn't realize when you jump off is you kick off like you do on the ground. You don't realize you push off. You push off. Well, when I pushed off, all of the recoil got shoved back when the pole bent back. And I'm like, no. And I reach out and I grab for the ring and my fingers just catch the tip of it. Boom. And I fall up like that and I fall down. But luckily, I'm still hanging because they've got me suspended by these safety lines. And I came down and vowed I'd never do that again. I don't know if you've ever done anything similar to that, anything in your life that's like scary, but you just took a leap of faith and you did it before. But we're going to talk today about faith. The writer of Hebrews states, you know, my wife talked about getting out your notes, and if you don't have them, get those out there. But the very first scripture there at the very top simply states in the book of Hebrews, it is impossible to please God without faith. It is impossible. You cannot please God unless you have faith in him. In fact, you cannot receive God into your life without faith. It takes faith to believe in God, to receive him into your life, to become a follower of Jesus. And in fact, scripture tells us that you can't pray effective prayers without faith. That it takes faith. You can't just pray and ask God for something and expect that, like, well, whatever's going to happen. In fact, James, the author James says in James 1, verse 5, I believe he says, anyone lacks wisdom, ask God who gives generously without finding fault. But when he asks, he must believe and not doubt, because he who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. Does nothing for you if you reach out to God, but you don't have faith in what you're believing God for. We're going to talk about that today. We're continuing this series that we started last week called Rich on Paper, Poor on Life. And each week in this series, this is not a money series, but rather understanding that the richness and satisfaction in our life does not come from our bank account or our bank statement, but rather it comes from other areas. We're going to tackle five. They're not all of the areas, but they're five major areas in your life that we're going to tackle that give you a rich and satisfying life. Last week, we talked about how your life needs purpose. We said that the two most important days in a person's life is, number one, the day they were born, and number two, the day they figured out why. God placed you on this planet, one of over 8 billion people, and not one of them is like you, and he has a specific and special plan for your life. What is it? It should be your life's passion to pursue what it is God called you to be and to live that out. Here's the thing. If you figure out why you are here, which takes a little doing to pursue that, but if you figure out why you're here, you're going to find out really quickly to do what God called you to do is not a walk in the park. It is a leap of faith. Much like climbing, if you're scared of heights, to the top of a pole and lunging off, hoping that the lines that are attached to your back by a harness are going to catch you. And a lot of times God calls us to step out. He says, I created you for this. And you finally find what it is you created for you. And you're like, oh, now I know what I'm here for. He's like, great. Now let's get started. And then he asks you to do stuff. You're like, oh, wait, hold up. You want me to do what? No, I think my ears are not. What'd you say again? Are you sure? And we have a hard time actually taking that step of faith that God has called us into. What I want to talk to you today and hope that you leave here with today is a crazy faith that maybe you didn't come in with in the beginning. I'm not talking about crazy like loony, but like you just have such a crazy faith that you trust God in everything that he calls you to do and you believe him for it. Do you know all the characters in the Bible, you want to go through and list them up, all the characters in the Bible, none of them had weak, like understated, like just subdued faith. They weren't quiet and reserved with it. There's a guy by the name of Peter. He's out on a lake in a boat, and a storm whips up on the lake. Jesus, of course, he's God. He can do this. He's walking on water, and he calls Peter out of the boat to walk on the water with him. Have you ever thought about that, getting in a boat on the middle of a lake, and she's like, I'm going to step out, and it's nighttime, and it's a storm, and you don't have a life preserver on? I'm just going to take a step out there. If God called you to do something like that, could you do it? That takes some crazy faith. There was a guy by the name of Noah. God told him to build this giant boat, and he's going to put a zoo on it. It's going to be a floating zoo. Trust me, Noah, this flood's coming. I know you've never seen a flood, but it's coming. And I want you to build this boat. It's going to take you over 100 years to build it, but just trust me on this one. And then I want you to pull all these animals into it and get it and lock it up and wait and hope that something happens. It takes crazy faith to do something like that. There was a guy by the name of David who was just a shepherd boy, just a small small shepherd boy. He was not a warrior. He was not a fighting man, but he came in to deliver food to his brothers who were on the front lines fighting a battle. And the enemy they were fighting, the Philistines, had this giant champion named Goliath who's said to be over 9 feet tall. He wore this armor, and everyone in all of Israel was scared to death of him, and he was cursing God. And David said, "Don't you dare curse my God. Give me a chance at Goliath." And he goes out there without any armor on, and he takes his shepherd sling, goes down to a brook and picks up 5 smooth stones and put them in his satchel and walks up to the giant, takes one in his sling and flings it at him, and with one shot hits him in the gap in his armor in his head. It says the stone sunk into his head and he fell dead. Takes crazy faith to do the things that God calls you to do. But guess what? It seems crazy until it happens. And then it's like, oh, yeah, I kind of knew God. You know, God's good. Yeah, you know, like I always trust God. You know, after something happens, it's a lot easier to go, yeah, God's good, isn't he? On the front end, while you're waiting, not so easy. And some of you guys are here today, and God has given you something. He's put something in your heart that you just keep pushing back down because in your mind, you're like, no way. There's no way I can do that. I can't. That's too complicated. That's too hard. That's too scary. There's too many unknowns. And you're waiting because you don't think. And by the way, if you feel like if you told somebody out loud what God has placed in your heart that he wants you to do, you'd think that they would say you were crazy. Of course, until it happens, until you actually go through with it and God shows himself to be real. And all of a sudden, now it's like, oh, faith. That's an easy thing after the fact. But before the fact, that's a completely different thing. I got this thing right here in my hand. In 1985, just about 40 years ago, this would have been considered crazy and impossible. Like, I remember as a kid, my big dream was to get a portable TV. And for those of you guys who remember back in the 80s, a portable TV was this big cabinet. It was like about this tall, and it had like this little 4 or 5 inch screen, a tube TV, and it was about this deep and had a big antenna on it, and it still had to plug in. But I was like, the dream of being able, and then one day, to think that we would be walking around with a little device like this that could last for hours and call people and it'd be a calculator and it can like look up people. I can talk to somebody on the other side of the planet with their video showing up on my screen instantaneously. That's crazy. Someone had an idea. Someone started where they were at and they worked that idea and they stayed persistent and consistent on that idea. And now we have this device that is kind of like crack cocaine for us. None of us thought at all of leaving this thing behind this morning. We had to have it with us. You all have it with you in your pocket right now or your purse. And if you're wondering right now, you're probably checking. Oh, yeah, it's still there. Crazy? Only on the front end. But if we trust God, you will see things happen you could never believe, you could never imagine would actually happen. He will work through in your life. So let's go on a journey today, discover what it takes to have crazy faith. Crazy faith, by the way, is not where you start in your notes. It's where you find yourself after you diligently and dedicate yourself to the exercise of baby faith. Faith starts small. Faith starts small. We're like looking forward to the opportunity to see God do crazy stuff in our life. But before we can see that happen, we actually have to take the first step. You've heard the saying before, a thousand mile journey begins with a single step. How do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. You have to start somewhere. You have to take a step. Jesus, as he was talking in scripture in Matthew chapter 17, he says, "I tell you the truth." He's talking to his disciples. He says, "I tell you the truth, if you had faith, even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it would move. Nothing would be impossible." You know how big a mustard seed is? Take a look at this. This is a mustard seed. If you had, Jesus is saying, just the smallest speck of faith in your life, and you trusted me, you could move mountains. Nothing would be impossible for you, but you have to start with the small stuff. Because we have a hard time even doing the simple stuff, like maybe start with reading your Bible every day, trusting that is the good thing and the right thing, that it'll get you closer to the heart of God, that'll lead you on the path you need to go on. Trust that you should be praying every day, not just once, but throughout the day. Trust that there are things you should do. Maybe there's somebody in your life who is in need of something. They're going through a tough situation and you pray for them. And you've prayed for them every day for 36 days straight and nothing has happened. But you stick with it. You start with the small stuff. You see, we always have these plans in our mind. We scheme and we plan, and we come with ideas of how we think it should play out when we pray and expect God to answer it. And it never does in our timing and in the way we expect it to. But you stay consistent. You trust him in those baby steps. God, I'm trusting you. I know you haven't answered in the affirmative yet on this one, but I'm trusting you will, and I'm going to keep praying for it. Crazy faith starts with baby faith. Starts small like that little mustard seed. Faith starts with the everyday leap of faith in the small things. Ask yourself this question right now. What's a small thing right now that God is asking you to take a step of faith in that you need to trust him for? It starts with your obedience to those things. There have been times in my life where I felt like this gnawing urge to do something that I could not explain that went against every fiber of my being, and I would do it anyways. It was a crazy time. It was just a few months ago. There was a gentleman in the parking lot behind our building, and as I was leaving work one day, he was out there he had his hood up and looked like maybe he had a dead battery, and I was on my way out, and I kept hearing, go to him, go help him, see if he needs help. And I was like, nah, it's dumb. He's got a battery pack. He's good. And it just got louder and louder. Finally, I'm like at the driveway exit right here. I'm like, okay, I'm supposed to try. I think I was talking about trusting God that week. And I was like, all right, God. So I whipped it around, came back and went back to the guy. And he was okay. Everything was cool. But you know what it meant to him, that the pastor of the church next to where he worked stopped to see what he needed? And the conversation we started and the relationship we developed just in the parking lot talking to him, I don't know if one day that's going to lead somewhere. But I do know this, that if God has called you to do something small, don't ignore it. He will whisper to you. But if you don't listen to the whisper, he might raise his voice a little bit. And if you don't listen to that, he might start shouting. And if you don't listen to that, he might give you a little push. And if you don't listen to that, he might just as well knock you flat on your back. Listen to God. Listen to what he's calling you for and step forward into that. Maybe the greatest breakthrough in your life won't start big. Maybe it'll start in the small stuff. Maybe right now you're in the middle of it, but you're not acknowledging that you're just kind of going through the grind, living out what you feel like God has called you to do, and you're not sure where it's going, but you're not sharing it with anybody because it's not really Instagrammable to talk about integrity. Facebook is not a place where you can get on there and you can Facebook your faithfulness. And so you're just quietly doing what God has called you to, and you're like, I don't know where this is going. I don't really see any results. You trust him. You keep stepping forward in faith. Faith starts small. But I want you to understand that the key to crazy faith isn't that it just starts small, but in your notes, number two, faith begins. It has its genesis in our imagination. Faith starts in our imagination. Our imagination is a lot more spiritual than you may have ever imagined, pun intended. As adults, somewhere along the way, we've allowed our enemy, the devil, to steal, to kill, and destroy our imaginations. I want to go to Scripture right now and share with you how biblical your imagination is. If you go to Genesis chapter 1, first chapter in the Bible, it's also in your notes there if you want to follow along that way. But Genesis chapter 1, and you got to go to verse 27. And in Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, this is a record of God as he creates the world. He just created human beings in verse 27. So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Now that word image actually comes from the Latin word imago. In fact, there's a term, imago Dei, which means image of God. In fact, there's a church in Portland called Imago Dei. The church's name is Image of God. But this idea imago is the idea that that we are an imitation or reflection of the thing that we are an image of. So you say imago Dei, that means we're an image, a reflection, an imitation of who God is, image of God. But image and imagination actually share the same root word. In fact, the Latin word for imagination is, let's see if I can get this right, imaginatio. And it's the idea to picture to oneself. Now, this is interesting. It's the idea that we get an image in our own mind of something. The image. Now here's the thing. This is the crazy thing. Is that God created us in his image from his imagination. It was God's imagination that created who you are. Yes, everything about you, your crazy lumps and bumps and your hair color and all the stuff you like and don't like about yourself, God made that. He imagined it and he created it from his imagination. You are an image made from God's imagination. In fact, turn to the person next to you and say, man, I look good. Because God made you good. He says in Scripture, God saw what he made and said it was good. But here's my point. God's imagination created us. We are created in his image. We are created in his likeness. Therefore, we can also create with imagination. That's the way God designed us. This is the tool that God gave you to be in the exactly opposite situation and yet feel or see something different. The author Paul in the New Testament, one of the most prolific authors in the New Testament, writes a bunch of what he writes about freedom from a prison cell. How in the world? He talks, in fact, the book of Philippians that he writes is called the book of joy because Paul says so many times, have joy, count it all joy, rejoice in the Lord. He's in prison talking about joy. How can he do that? Because he doesn't see his present circumstances. He sees beyond that in his imagination. The only way that you can be in a situation racked by fear and anxiety in your life currently right now, but see yourself in the near future and living in peace, the only way that you can have physical unhealth in your body, but see yourself one day as whole, is this tool that God has given us, this beautiful gift of imagination. The problem is most of us have shut it down. We got to a certain age, we're like, that is immature, that's something kids do, and we just put the kibosh on it. It's like, we're done with that one. Put imagination away. That's silly and frivolous. Let the kids play around with imagination, but we as adults, we have to grow up. But I want you right now, if you would, close your eyes with me. Everyone close your eyes. And I want you to imagine, if you will, that you're sitting on an exotic beach on vacation. And right now, some of you guys are already there. I just heard you. You're sitting in a lawn chair low to the ground. You can put your hand down beside you and feel the soft, powdery, white sand next to you. And you hear the gentle waves lapping up on the shore and the warm, gentle breeze blowing against you, sipping on a drink, your favorite fruit drink with an umbrella in it. And you're just having some time. Now open up your eyes. Now some of you are like, that's silly, that's stupid, I'm not going there. You are adults who have tried to grow up too quick. But some of you guys are already pulling out your favorite travel app looking for the next vacation because you were there for just a moment. Just for a moment, you had that. That is the tool, the power, the gift that God has given us of our imagination. You saw a glimpse. You saw it before you actually saw it. This idea of seeing something before you experience it. God wants to use our anointed imagination. Let me explain. That word anointed sometimes can seem a little bit complex. Anointed just means that you have God's approval. Your anointed imagination is your imagination approved by God. He wants to take your anointed imagination and he wants to empower us to live out a life for his glory. He wants us to have the ability to create new ideas or pictures that are not present to the senses, but one day could be. He wants to use them. I see this in Matthew chapter 18 in your notes. Jesus is addressing his disciples at the beginning of chapter 18. He just catches the disciples, his followers. I don't know about you. This maybe encourages you like it encourages me. His disciples are actually arguing with each other about who's the greatest. Like you follow around God in the flesh, and he's been teaching you, training you. And at one point in time, he's like, I'm doing good. And he turns around and he's like, wait, what is that? What are you guys talking about? Oh, I'm just telling Peter I'm better than him. Like, what's that all about? Jesus responds with this in Matthew chapter 18, verse 2 and 3. Says, Jesus called a little child to him and put the child among them. He puts his child among his disciples. Then he said, I tell you the truth. Unless you turn from your sins and become like little children, you will never get into the kingdom of heaven. Now we get the sin thing. It's like, yeah, okay, we're supposed to be right. We're supposed to be good. I get that. You know, we got to turn from our sins. But become like children? What do you mean by that, Jesus? Here's a key to the kingdom, because Jesus himself says that you cannot get into the kingdom of heaven unless you become like little children. Here's a key to the kingdom. Act more like kids. Act more kiddie. You need to be a little more like a child. When God says something, kids, believe it. When God shows you something, you believe it as a kid. I'm not saying be more immature. Grow up. Be mature. But have some of those childlike traits that you've lost and bring them back to you. You know you were called children of God, not work partners, not business associates, not allies. He calls us children of God. He wants us to have that imagery that we are children of him. You know what kids do? Kids trust. Kids listen. When you tell them the sky's blue, they're like, okay. You turn around and tell them it's purple, like, okay. Like, whatever. Kids just trust you. They believe. Kids obey. Well, at least some of them, maybe not yours. My kids were perfect. The kids are a lot more apt to obey up to a certain point in life. Kids imagine. There's a picture of me I want to show you guys. This is a picture of me as a kid. Oh, so cute. Such a little boy there. Playing in the sand, by the way, using my imagination to build a sandcastle that was not, but I saw it in my head and I made it happen. You know what I like about this kid when I look at him? See, here's the thing. I've gone through a whole Bible college degree. I've spent most of my adult life a student of Scripture, studying it, trying to live it out, trying to be better, to grow in my faith, to grow in my understanding of God. But you know what I envy about this kid right here? He just believed. He just trusted God. He just did it because God says you're supposed to do it. He obeyed. And you know what I do now? I'm a skeptic. I'm like, really? Are you sure about that, God? Like, can you prove it to me? Can you maybe give me a little sign to show me that this is the right thing? And I'm so skeptical, and I've got to actually do my homework and make sure that I'm prudent, and the steps I take are responsible steps instead of just trusting God because he's never failed me, and say, you know what, God, if you said, I don't understand it, but I'm going to do it because you said to do it. I envy that. Do you remember when you were a child and you just believed? And then one day, your childlike spirit was stolen from you. Trials and tragedies and troubles came into your life and you were forced to grow up. And you had to put all that stuff behind you. But God wants us to anoint our imagination to believe again what he can do through us. We have to reclaim that. But you can't do that because you've been adulting too much, so you've lost God's anointing on your imagination. What we need to do, guys, today is to get our imagination back. You know what the author of Hebrews says in your notes? Hebrews 11, chapter 11, verse 1, he says, faith shows the reality of what we hope for. It is the evidence of things we cannot see. We need to imagine it and then hope for it. Then we can get our faith back. Because our faith begins in our imagination. Your imagination is the womb of your spirit. Whatever you start imagining is what begins to form in your life. Did you know this? That a lot of you deal with anxiety. Did you know that anxiety is the offspring of fear mixed with imagination? You have fears about something, so you start imagining what will happen if those things come to pass. And they, by the way, most of the time never do. In fact, according to the statistics, 93% of the stuff we come up with, bonehead ideas we come up with in our head, and we imagine what's going to happen, 93% of them never come to fruition. And every time we get one of those lucky ones, one of those 7%, we're like, see? See? That's why. That's why I live my life racked with fear and anxiety, because you never know. I don't want to be duped. It's going to sneak up on me. I can't have that. But you dwell on that and you let your imagination run wild. By the way, that's not anointed imagination when you're letting your imagination run wild on things that are not from God. You do not have his approval on those things that you imagine. This is why we need to be careful, by the way, about what we watch and what we listen to. The people that we're hanging out with, the shows, the entertainment that we expose ourselves to, we have to watch it. Because as it goes into our minds, we start to mull it over and we begin to imagine on these things. And all of a sudden, things we never even thought of could be reality, they're like, oh, that's an interesting idea. I watched that guy get murdered on that detective show. What if I got snuck up on like that? And all of a sudden, our imagination runs wild. And we start getting racked with depression and anxiety and fear in our lives. We need to do what Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 10:5. In your notes, we destroy arguments and every lofty opinion raised against the knowledge of God. And listen to this, take every thought captive to obey Christ. That's what we need to do. One version, the King James Version, actually says that we destroy arguments. It says we fight against imaginations. Interesting. Because you know where arguments come from? These arguments that destroy us? from our imagination, and we let them get out of control. And what Paul says, he says we need to take captive these thoughts. We need to restrain these things. We need to put some restraints on them. Take them captive so that we can obey Christ. Martin Luther, the theologian hundreds of years ago, said this. He says it this way: you can't stop a bird from flying over your head, but you can stop it from landing on your hair and making a nest there. You know, thoughts come our way. It's not that we think something that's so awful. It's the fact that we're like, hey, come here, little birdie. And we let that bird land on our head and begin to make its nest and its home there. And we just mull it over. Paul says, no, you take captive that thought. You push that bird away. Take that away. So faith begins in our imagination. Here's the third thing. This is how we are able to take our imaginations and take our thoughts captives. Number three, imagination is purified through intercession. Another fancy word that's used in church, intercession, is this idea of calling on God in prayer. It's the idea of interceding for yourself or on behalf of yourself or someone else. You're calling out to God. Think about anything. You can think of anything rather, but then you need to bring it to God in prayer. God, I had this thought. What do you think of it? You ever do that with your parents when you were a little kid? Hey, Mom and Dad, what do you think about this? And get their feedback on it. We wish they'd do it as they get older. They stop doing it as they get older. Guess what we do? We lean into God when we're younger, and then we get to some age where we think we've matured enough that we no longer need God's expert opinion on the situation. But maybe when a thought comes to your mind and it's like not a pleasant thought, or it doesn't feel like it's right in some way, you bring this before God and say, God, here's my thought. Here's what's going on. What do you say? Weigh in on this for me. That same boy that you saw in the picture on the screen earlier, building a sandcastle, you know what that boy could do? That boy could take something like this and be like, oh, my imagination had no shortage of creative ideas. I would watch movies, my brothers and I would watch movies about medieval knights, and we'd take the yardsticks out of the closet and wrap them in foil and put a little point on them, and we would have little broadsword fights in the house. My mom was not a fan of it, but we did this. Anybody else like me in the 80s watch The Karate Kid, and after it was over, you're like, right? Like, I saw myself up on that stump. I knew I could do it. Our imaginations run wild. What if what God is saying to you, he's saying, you know what, you're down here, but I want to make your ideas soar. I want them to soar. And you know that anxiety? Fear? Depression? If you'll listen to me and let me guide the path of your life, I can make these things come to pass. Guys, there's so much more in store for your life than what you've experienced when you let God in and you unlock that crazy faith that he so desperately wants you to have. So that purpose we talked about last week can be put into action, and you can trust him and watch things happen you never thought were possible in your life. That's what God wants to do. This week, I want you to imagine God changing your situation. What's your situation right now? What are you going through? What struggles, what challenge are you faced with? I want you to imagine your situation and how God can change that around. And I'm not saying, by the way, to do something yet. What I'm saying to you today is I want you now to go to God in prayer and ask him about that. Hey, God, here's the situation. Here's what I saw. Is that where you're leading me? Do you have another direction you want to take me? My wife and I, when we bought the house that we live in now, went on this crazy journey for, I don't know, it was like a year, looking for homes. We were wanting to buy our first home, and we bid on three different houses. One of them, the offer was accepted, and before we closed, the seller ripped the house out from underneath us, and we had already got a family party together. We had imagined in our minds how we were going to decorate it. We'd gone to the hardware store, how we were going to remodel this house and make it our own, and we got a call from a realtor saying, I'm so sorry, the house is gone. And my wife got angry with me after that third house, and she said this, because here's what I've been doing. Every time we had a house, I said, God, if this is the one for us, make it possible. Open up the door. But if it's not, shut it, slam it in our face. And she got angry with me after the third house. She says, would you stop praying that prayer? I'm done. And I'm like, do you really want it if God's shutting the door? She's like, We actually put the house thing on hold for like 6 months and didn't come back for it. And you know what? What came up is we happened to be this new neighborhood where we live now. They were building these houses. And we went through this neighborhood and we found this house. And we called our real estate agent on it after walking through it. She's like, oh, didn't I tell you? With it being new construction, you have a different cap. You can actually afford that house. It was the house we wanted in the beginning all along, but we couldn't afford. You don't know what God is doing in your life. You don't know where he's going to lead you. What you need to do is trust him because he's always proven himself to be faithful. He will always come through for you in your life, but it takes a step of faith. You'll fall on your face several times in that process of learning how to trust him and understanding what way he's saying to go and which way he's saying not to go. But I promise you, if you trust him, great things will happen in your life. Here's what you need to do. What Proverbs 3, 5, and 6 says this. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. That's too good to not say that twice. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. There's that faith thing. Take that crazy step of faith. Do not depend on your own understanding, which we're so good at doing. Like, are you sure, God? Because I think E equals MC squared, and I got this thing figured out. I know what to do. I've been up against this before, God. I know what to do here. Really? I need to trust you? Don't depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do. Seek him out. God, would you show me which path to take? And he will show you which path to take. It's as simple as that. I want to share with you quickly three things that intercession can do for you as you call out to God in your situation. The first one is this: intercession changes your focus. It'll change your focus. Could I get you guys to put me on the screen here really quick on the video? Can you put me up on the screen? All right. And camera guy back there, can you, is that JT back there? Can you put me out of focus? Take me out of focus there. Oh, see, you can't even see all the beautiful details of my face now anymore. It's all hidden. But a lot of times, this is our life, and we're looking at it. We're going, what way do I go? I can't really even tell. What is that fuzzball in front of me? Is that a person? I really don't know. We're like, God, can you help me in this situation? Can you show me which path to take? And as we ask God, guess what? He starts to clear that up. We begin to see that focus begin to sharpen and hone in. And pretty soon, it's like, oh, okay, I see what you're doing. Okay, I trust you. I'm going for it. Okay, this is where I'm going, God. Intercession will change your focus. The second thing is this: intercession changes your feelings. We in our culture are a lot of times are dominated by our feelings. We follow our feelings so often, and they many times lead us astray. Our feelings will lie to us. They will tell us something is true that is not true because it feels true, yet it's not true. And what God will do is God will anoint the feelings that we're going through. He will give us the right feelings as we're going through situations. So, you know, you come in and you're sitting down in a classroom at school and you're like, oh, God, that boy? He's like, no, not him. This guy, you're like, him? Really? That guy? He's like, trust me. You're like, oh, my dream home. I told you about my dream home guy. And the guy's like, no, not that one. That one. Intercession will change us. It'll change our focus and it'll change your feelings. And God will get your, instead of your feelings being locked onto the wrong thing, going the wrong direction, he will latch your feelings onto the right thing, because the more you trust him and the more you lean into him, the things that God desires for your life become your desires as well. Instead of your feelings following your fleshly nature to do what you selfishly want to do, your feelings begin to follow his desires for you instead. And here's the last thing. Intercession changes your future. Scripture tells us that the prayers of a righteous person are powerful and effective. In fact, there was a guy by the name of Elijah, and in the author James, in the fifth chapter of his book, talks about Elijah. He says, Elijah was a man just like us. He prayed earnestly that it would not rain on the land, and it did not rain for 3.5 years. Again, he prayed, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth produced its crops. Elijah was a man just like us. James is very clear to point that out to us. He didn't have anything more special than we have, except for his complete dependence on God. And he said, God, would you work in this situation? When you intercede with God, when you come to him in prayer with your imagination, say, God, here's what I'm seeing. Now I want you to hone this in. He will crisp up that focus. He's going to make your feelings go the right direction. And he's going to adjust your future. Not the future that you had in mind, but the future that he had in mind for you. We're about ready to embark on a journey. We do this a couple times a year. But starting next Sunday, September 15th, we're beginning a season of prayer called 21 Days of Prayer. And if you don't know what that is, it's 21 days of prayer. We're at the creative, most creative in the way we label stuff, but it's clear at least. And starting next Sunday, if you want to go on this journey with us and this idea of intercession, and that's what we're going to be doing for 21 days, is interceding, a focused season of prayer where we say, God, we're calling on you to show us what you want to do in our personal life and what you want to do with us corporately as a church as we go into the fall and beyond. What do you want to do through us? Give us a burden for the people who don't know you yet, the people who have no hope, that are in our very lives. God, sharpen our focus so that we're going the way that blesses you rather than the way that we think is good that blesses us. And then we're going to be praying for 3 weeks, focusing on our next generation. Those that are coming behind us. That's different for each person. No matter what season in your life, there are people who are behind you. And we're going to pray for 3 weeks that God would open up our eyes to how we can invest in their lives and how God's favor can rest upon them as they grow up and this next generation moves into positions of influence in our culture, that they would be able to influence our culture for Jesus. 21 days. 21 days. And if you want to sign up for this, by the way, it's a next step on your notes today. On the back of your connection card, number 3, you can check that box. And here's what I'll do if you'll check that box with me. Starting next Sunday, I will email you in the morning for all 3 weeks, for every 21 of those days, I will email you a prayer focus, something you can focus your prayers on. What I would like for you to do now, if that's someone who's checked that box and wants to be a part of that, is that you begin preparing your heart for that. Remove the distractions. One of the greatest things that pulls us away from God is the distractions of our busy lives. And focus attention and say, God, I'm going to make prayer, interceding for this season, a priority in my life. And I'm actually going to sacrifice things that I'd rather do. I'm going to give up 7 minutes every day of doom scrolling. It's going to be a big sacrifice, God. What are you willing to give up for him? And for the next 21 days, starting next week, put our attention and our focus on him. I can imagine in the heavenly realms, as our people begin praying together in unison, the angels are coming up to God. God, look over there, Hillsboro. Do you see what's going on over there? There's a whole group of people. I don't know what's going on, but they're all on the same page talking about the same stuff. And they're focused, God. Should we act? Should we do something? See, God wants to, and he's waiting for his children to call out to him so he can act on their behalf. What kind of crazy thing does God want to do through your life, through your personal life? In your family, your business, your career, your neighbors. What is God impressing on your heart today? And then what's one simple, crazy step you can take, a small one, forward in that direction and trust God and watch and see what'll happen. I want that for you. 1 Corinthians 2:9 in your notes. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined. Now, how great our imaginations are, no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. I want you to have a crazy faith that God would work in your childlike crazy faith, and you'd see things beyond anything in your wildest imagination. In fact, I want for you what Paul says in Ephesians 3:20. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is in work within us. Would you bow your heads? Would you pray this prayer with me? God, we ask today for a breakthrough today in our faith. We know that even little faith, the faith of a mustard seed, can move mountains. We know that we can't please you without faith. So we ask you, God, today, would you build our faith, build it in our hearts today? Help us to believe for miracles, for supernatural healing, for divine provision, for restoration in relationships, for ideas and imagination to do what you've called us to do in our personal lives and at our businesses, at our work, for kingdom impact. God, give us the faith to think big, but the courage to start small. Remind us that it is you working in us, and that if you are for us, who can be against us? So we ask in faith today, believing for your power, for your intervention, for your miracles. We believe you and we trust you. And we know that even if you don't come through in the area we want you to come through for, we still ask with faith, believing today for those miracles. If you'll keep your head bowed for just a moment, I want to address those of you in the room who have never actually made a personal decision to follow Jesus with your life. You acknowledge that Jesus is God and that you want to surrender your life to him today. I promise you, if you do this, it'll be the greatest adventure you ever go on. It'll be scary, scarier than you can imagine. But you trust him. I promise you, it'll be the best decision you've ever made. And I ask you today, can you give any reason right now, any logical reason why you shouldn't trust him? If that's you today, I want to say a simple prayer with while your heads are still bowed. And as I pray this prayer out loud, I invite you in your own heart to pray this prayer along with me as your way of receiving him into your life. Pray this: Heavenly Father, forgive me of all my sins. Jesus, I surrender my life completely to you. I'm giving you everything. Fill me with your Holy Spirit so I can know you, to live for you, and to walk by faith and not by sight. God, give me faith to show your love, to know your will, to be a bright light in a dark world. Build my faith to know you and to make you known. I give my whole life to you today. It's in your name I pray this, Jesus. Amen. Look up here if you would. And if you just said that prayer for the very first time, if you just surrendered your life to him, would you do me a favor? And that orange connection card my wife was waving around earlier, if you take this out and you check that first next step today, I'm making a first-time decision to follow Jesus. Best decision you've ever made. And if you'll check that box and at least get your name and email address on there, one thing we want to do is we want to celebrate with you. We will pray and thank God and rejoice with you. And number two, we'd like to send you an email with some resources to help you know your first steps you might take on this new faith journey. And so if you'll just check that box, we'd love to do that for you. And again, I want to invite you, number three, I want to participate in 21 days of prayer beginning next Sunday, September 15th. So if you will, I would love it if everyone, in my heart would be blessed, if everyone in this room checked that box and said, yes, I'm going to step out in faith. I'm going to go on that journey. I'm going to trust God. And I'm going to intercede. I'm going to intercede on behalf of what he wants to do in my life and in the lives of the people around us as we look forward to what he's going to do through us this fall in the community. And I would encourage you to check that box. I'll be in touch with you later this week to prepare you. And then, of course, starting on Sunday, I'll send you that email every day to give you that prayer focus. Let's see. What's something else? Oh, yes, we're going to have the buckets come by in a few minutes. There's some buckets we pass by every week, and that's your opportunity. If you have an offering you'd like to give, to drop that in. Also, finish filling out these orange cards and get that dropped there in there as well, so that we can get you the appropriate information for any boxes you checked and all that. And by the way, it's worth saying, we say it a lot, but this is not a one card per household deal. This is a one card per person, so everyone fill it out. If we only have a family name on there, we don't necessarily know who specifically we're praying for or what specifically we're giving the information out to. So get your name on there individually and fill that card out there and get that turned in there when the bucket comes by here in a moment. I'm going to ask the team to come forward to those buckets now. As they're coming forward, would you bow your heads with me as we pray to receive the offering? Lord God, we just want to pause and say thank you. When we think of how good you've been to us, that you love us so much, you want a personal relationship with us, and you gave everything so that we could have that relationship with you. And your blessings and favor are in our lives. So today, God, as we give our offerings, keep us mindful of that. Fill our hearts with gratitude. And as we give our offerings, may they be an expression of that gratitude, the joy in our hearts, the love that we have for you, and our obedience in following you. So take our offerings, God, and use them today above and beyond anything we could ever ask or imagine. In your name we pray. Amen. Watch that bucket as it passes by your row. While it's coming by, I do want to encourage you to be a part of 21 Days of Prayer next week as we can. And by the way, we do one in January called 21 Days of Prayer and Fasting, but we call this one 21 Days of Prayer and Feasting because we are not asking you to necessarily stop any kind of eating habits or anything like that. But I would say this, that if you feel compelled to, man, step out and do that. I know I'll probably be doing something that I'll be fasting from during this season, but we'd love to have you be a part of that journey as we go collectively. And keep tuned in, because we actually might have a prayer service one night, and we might actually have some opportunities for us to gather together throughout that three-week period of time for prayer time as a group. So just be aware of that coming up. And the next week, come back. Next week, I'm excited already about what I'm going to share with you guys, the third thing that we need in our life to give us a rich and satisfying life. Please come back and understand this. There are people that you know that you are in contact with every week. You work next to them. You drive beside them. You eat at their restaurant. You shop groceries at their store. You're connected with so many different people who are going through life, and on the surface, it looks like everything's great, but I promise you inside, they're struggling. And if you invite them, there's a step of faith. You take a step out of faith and say, you got invite cards, by the way, on the information table, the little business cards. You can go grab those and you hand them out to someone and say, hey, I've never had anyone go, why did you give me that? Everyone's always thanked me for it. And because I've done that, many people have showed up and their lives have been blessed and changed by the love and hope that Jesus has to offer. I promise you, bring them back. And then don't just say, show up here. Tell them, hey, if you're coming, let me know. I'll meet you out front so you're not alone, because there are a bunch of crazy, ugly, scary people that are here. And I will come in with you, and I got your back. And they can come sit with you, and you can help them be a little more comfortable as they come in because they know somebody. But I encourage you to invite someone back with you, because there is a hope and a love that we have to share with people that we have received. We don't want to be selfish with it. And I will tell you this, I feel urgent. The time is short that we have. If we don't use the time God has given us, it'll be taken away from us. So take these opportunities and watch how God will bless not only you, but bless the people that you reached out and took a chance on. Why don't you stand up as you're preparing to leave today? Say hi to a few folks that you sat near. I'll be out on the patio. I'd love to say hi. Come by and say hi and have a fantastic week. We'll see you back here next Sunday. I'm risking it all. Knowing your kids and all my pieces as they fall.